Well, good morning, Westview. Welcome here. So good to be together this morning. Great to have this opportunity to gather together to worship the Lord. My name is Tyler. I'm one of the pastors here. And so welcome. Great to have you here this morning. We want to say a special welcome to all of you worshiping with us through our live stream as well. Delighted to have you with us this morning. And pray that just this will be a morning where God connects with us and meets with us in a special way. And I want to share with you a few announcements before we do so. A couple of quick things. We have connect cards in the seat pockets. We'd love for you to connect with us if you're newer to Westview. We'd love to be able to follow up with you and just hear your story, get to know you, call you by name. You can fill those out, or there is a digital QR code as well. If you scan that, if you want to save some trees, that's cool. We appreciate that. And we can connect with you as well. But either way, meet me in the foyer at the Welcome Center afterwards. I'd love to give you a little gift, just our way of saying welcome here this morning. Couple announcements. Cadre begins tonight. Love this. It is so exciting to be able to be launching these ministries in this season. It feels like it's been a little while, and so we are excited to launch Cadre. There is still time if you would like to sign up for our financial discipleship course. It begins tonight. Each lesson builds upon each other, but you can just come to one if that works. I'd encourage you to come tonight. A huge part of our journey of discipleship is understanding finances and what God asks of us with what he has provided to us. And I'd encourage you to sign up. You can still do so on our website, even right now. We'd love to see you tonight. It begins at 6:30. For those of you who are a part of our first cohort as well meeting tonight, you have all of your email information on that one. So we will see you tonight at 6:30 for that. Speaking of new to Westview, we have our Welcome to Westview lunch happening on the 30th of this month. So in a couple of weeks, we're going to be gathering in the fireside room. We're going to be having a lunch together. This is something I am so looking forward to. It's been a few years, and we just want to be able to gather around the table, enjoy a meal together. So if you're new to Westview, and really that's kind of a nebulous term, like how new do I have to be to come? If you haven't been to one of these lunches in like the last 2 years plus, obviously, we haven't been doing them in the 2 years plus. We'd love for you to come. Sign up on our website, westviewchurch.ca/lunch is how you can sign up. All the information is there. We'd love to see you be our guests after the service on the 30th of October. Today is Picture Day. Hope you dressed up nicely. You might not even realize it's Picture Day. You're like, what? Hold on. It is Picture Day in the fireside room after the service and all Sunday next week. What we're looking to do is just get a photo database of headshots. You don't have to worry about anything else. You don't have to worry about combing your hair. We're not going to publish these for you to put on your fridge. But we're growing our database as a church to be able to know who's who. There's a lot lot of new people, and even for us as a congregation to know who is who. And so we'd love to encourage you to get your picture taken in the fireside room after the service. And again, it'll happen all Sunday next week as well. Last thing, as you came in this morning, you might have been given a couple of things. We are in the midst of this spiritual gifts series. We're calling it Superpowers, and there's a couple of things that we're really excited about to kind of work out our spiritual gifts, these practical outworkings. And one is, you might have received a bit of a questionnaire as you came in, and we're going to be working through that over the next little while here. It is also available on our website. We've digitized it to make it even easier for you to do. All the information is in that pamphlet, and we'll be sending out information by email. And so we'd love for you to be able to be a part of filling out that questionnaire as we grow as a church to be gift-based. That we know what our gifts are, we know what each other's gifts are, and we work them out in the context of the church, of the body, encouraging one another in that. And so we'd love to have you be a part of that. If you have any questions about that questionnaire, about anything that you've received in that pamphlet this morning, talk to me, talk to Gary. We'd love to journey with you in that, but we're just so excited for this practical piece in this Superpowers sermon series. Let me read this morning, church, from Psalm 51, verse 10, as we prepare our hearts to continue to worship. Psalm 51, verse 10 declares, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me." And so as morning, so worship team, continue to lead us.
Amen. Let's stand together as we worship the God of in my heart. In my heart, there's a fire burning, a passion deep within. Growing cold, an unquenchable flame that keeps burning brighter, a love that's blazing like the sun for who you are and what you've done. And In Hebrews chapter 10, there's a section that begins in verse 19 that reminds us of our full assurance of our faith. It reads, "Since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of our faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from all evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." Noise up here and let me hear you guys. Come on. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Fantastic. Good. That's good. Excellent. I think we're missing, might be missing Tolu, right? Okay. Other than that, you can see the names here. So Chris and Lindsay, Brittany, Slater, and Lindsay. Wait a second. Sydney. Thank you. I got that turned around. That's Sydney. This is Lindsay. I call these folks superheroes. And the reason is, and it was a privilege to connect with many of them through young adults, but one of the reasons I call them superheroes is because they have this ministry, and it goes on every single week, an evening every week, sometimes more. And it's for hours, and then they do retreats and weekends and all kinds of stuff. So it's a huge commitment, and they do it out of love and joy. It's amazing. Yeah. I want to invite a couple of people up as well to pray for them. So Wayne, if you are here, please, and Crystal, if you are here, would you please come up? We want to pray for these fine people. And I'm going to ask you all, if you would just take a step forward, please. Yeah, a little bit more. That'd be awesome. And then we're going to just come here, and you have a microphone there already. And I'm going to invite you to stand. And as we pray, if you feel comfortable, you can remain seated if you want to, if you're fine, but otherwise stand. And I'm going to invite you, if you're comfortable, just to put a hand out as an indication that you want to bless these people and virtually put your hands on their shoulders this morning. So let's do that. And Wayne, would you pray? And then Crystal, would you pray as well?
Gary, I was thinking, for all of us that have grown up in church, right, since we were young, how many of us went to youth group? And if you're like me, you could probably remember certain things that your youth leader said or did, because it sticks with you, right? It's not your parents telling you things, it's your youth leaders. And I've heard lots of stories about some of the youth leaders here and how they reacted to situations and what they did. So they have a real significant impact. Yeah. On the lives of our youth. And I can testify to that, and I'm sure many of you can as well. So let's pray.
Thanks,
Wayne. Heavenly Father, I want to pray for these wonderful individuals, these saints that are youth leaders. You know, Father, in so many ways, when it comes to the ministry of the gospel, you're looking at the frontline workers. You're looking at those that are impacting the next generation of saints. And so, Father, we thank you so much for their willingness to take the time to do what's required, take time out of their schedules to serve you, to give up, you know, what they could else otherwise be doing. Father, they're salt and light. That's what the Word says. They're salt and light, and salt and light to a group of society that a lot of times is probably feels alone, probably feels confused, probably don't know where they belong in a lot of cases. So I pray, Father, that they will continue to be salt and light to these kids that are so desperately needing a sense of belonging. We all want to belong to a group. Father, teach them how special they are as youth leaders in your eye. Always remind them about that they're children of yours and they belong to you and they have blessed assurance. Father, I pray that you'd give all of them just extra doses of encouragement, patience, self-control, encouragement, and most importantly, love for all the kids that come to the door. Father, I pray that they would draw close to you. As your word says, if we draw close to you, you will be close to us. Father, I pray that they would remain connected to the vine on a daily basis, because as your word says, we can't do anything in our own strength. We have to be connected to you. Help them, Father, on a daily basis to seek you, because again, you need to provide them with the power and all the spiritual blessings they're going to need to deal with the youth, and to offer that encouragement, acceptance, and love. In your precious and holy name, Father, amen.
And I'm going to pray for the youth here in our congregation today. So join me. God, we acknowledge your presence in the lives of our youth. In the midst of rushing off to school, navigating friendships, and sorting through the voices of our world, you are here. In the midst of anxieties, worries, and pressures to meet expectations, you are here. In the midst of a good grade, making the team, and discovering new potentials, you are here. You are present, real, and interested. God, we also acknowledge your infinite love and grace extended to our youth. When the world says you're not good enough, strong enough, smart enough, pretty enough, you give our youth the security of knowing they are complete, as is. When we as parents miss the mark and place more priority on our kids' performance, abilities, and achievements, you remind our youth they are unconditionally loved by you. When doubts arise and paths get confusing, your grace remains steadfast and available. God, we are grateful for these realities, and we eagerly anticipate all you have in store for our youth this year. Amen. Amen.
Now I commend you to the Lord and his ministry, who is able to do far more abundantly than all you could ask or imagine. To him be glory in your ministry, in this church, and to every generation, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
As we continue to worship, ignore this. Don't worry what's going on in here. Focus on me. We're going to continue to worship now through the giving of our tithes and gifts and offerings. And I just want to, again, just reiterate that as we worship through our giving, there are three ways to give here at Westview, and the information is on the screen. It's on your screen for those of you worshiping with us on our live stream. But I just want to acknowledge that one of the areas in which your tithes and gifts and offering goes to is our youth ministry. As someone who did youth ministry for 10 years, I recognize that we are blessed and thankful for the funds and the budgets that we have to be able to do this work. It's not cheap to do youth ministry. There are holes in the walls that we got to pay for, apparently. Stuff happens but the reality is what you are doing in your giving is sowing seeds of the gospel in transforming the lives of this generation of students who will go out from this place into hallways and classrooms and bring with them the good news and the presence of Jesus. And so we are so thankful for these youth leaders, and I speak as a pastor, and I speak as a parent. And so we thank you for the generosity that you do in your giving and what that does to make an incredible impact in the lives of these students and these leaders who I echo are saints. They are incredible, and we are so thankful for them. And so this morning, we are so thankful for Tosh and her return. We are so thankful for EJ and the blessing of his presence here in this last year. And we are thankful for you as a church who prays and commissions and loves and supports these students. So let's pray this morning. Lord, we do thank you. This morning as we gather, we thank you for the generosity of this church that gives sacrificially for these funds, fuel the work of ministry that impact the hearts of students who hear that they are loved, that they have purpose and worth and value, that you have a plan for their lives, that they're not failures and mistakes, Lord. And so we pray that in these evenings as they gather, these weekends as they retreat, all of these things, Lord, that you would be working, Holy Spirit. You would be at work in the hearts of our pastors, of our leaders who give so sacrificially of their time and their energy. We thank you for Emmanuel. We thank you for Tosh. I thank you, Lord, for the blessing of what our youth ministry means to this family, to us as a church. And so, Lord, thank you for these tithes and gifts and offerings, for the faithfulness of this family, of this church, as they give, as we worship through our tithes and gifts and offerings. And we thank you, Lord, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There is an offering box, I will say, at the doors as you head out this morning, and we do as well. We have a prayer team available to your right who would love to be able to pray with you following our service this morning, and so bring those requests, bring those needs, bring your presence to our prayer room, and our prayer team would love to be able to pray with you. Let's continue to worship.
I'll ask you to stand again. As the kids are leaving, you sing this out loud. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day's dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord.
Give him glory. hearts cry out to worship, whose glory taught the stars to shine. Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine.
Hebrews 7 tells us that Christ is the King, the kind of high priest we need, because he is holy and blameless and unstained by sin. And God appointed his Son the perfect high priest forever. I'll teach you a new song this morning. Believe, we'll sing the song of Abraham. wages to the Lamb. Your name is highest, your name is greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels sing, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever to the Lamb. Your name is greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers, positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation. Throughout the earth, Lord. place in your presence with your Spirit with us this morning. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill us. Come, Holy Spirit, teach us and change us, for you are holy. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the price you paid. Thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness to us. And hear your people cry, holy, holy is the Lord. We give you honor and praise this morning in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Yes, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Reese, and the music team, worship team, for leading us this morning in worship. Amen. Amen. Yes. We gather in Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit is here. It is really good to give gifts, budgets notwithstanding. But it is great, you know, to give gifts and receive gifts. And, of course, gifts say different things. For example, if you got to be careful about what kind of gifts you give. If you're married and you give your wife a treadmill for Christmas, for example. Or maybe you give your husband a gym membership, something like that. But so we have to be careful. And as we get older, we start, you know, realizing, well, maybe we don't need as many things, or maybe, you know, our friend or family member has a limited budget or is on a fixed income, and so we say it's all right, you don't need to bother. But the thing is, our Creator is not limited in His resources. And He gives. He is a giving God, and He gives. And He gives over and over and over through generation after generation after generation. And what He gives are gifts. But why does He give gifts? Or conversely, we could ask, why do we have certain gifts? Again, as a practice, later on this morning, we'll have an opportunity for Q&R, question and response. You can stand where you are. You can text or email. The address is on your screen there. And you can interact later on with what we're discovering and discussing here this morning. We're in the middle of our sermon series called Superpowers, and we're in the book of 1 Corinthians. It was a letter that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. In fact, Paul had planted this church in Corinth. It was on his second trip in that region after he had been to Athens, and he went to Corinth and he planted this church. Could you imagine, though, a church that is racked with divisions, as one commentator put it? They were in a major urban center. Of course, this doesn't look like it anymore. That could be Nose Hill, but it's not. That's in Corinth itself, a picture that Kimberly and I took. But they were in an urban center. They had a very diverse population and in the region as well. And they had all of these temples as well. The temple of Aphrodite, the goddess of love. They actually had cult prostitutes. In fact, there was a phrase, a Corinthian girl. And then there was the another temple of Asclepius, which was the Greek goddess of healing. And then there was also a site for Iset, Egyptian goddess, which was the equivalent of the Greek god Poseidon. So all of that was in this area in and around Corinth. And then people there also had these major ideals that they grew up with. One of their prominent ideals was individualism. Each person onto their own. Another ideal for them was freedom. And they defined freedom different ways. But basically it meant you can do whatever you want. And then also they adhered to what we would call secular standards of leadership and organization. So all of this was now shaping and influencing people that were now coming to First Church Corinth. And so you could imagine that what they were, the milieu, the context was sort of a religious context. And so they were mashing up this with what they understood Christianity to be, and it was developing what could also be called a form of a religion. And in their experience of religion, that meant either doing things to try and please or appease a god, or religion meant things to please yourself. And so then when they were coming to church, it was, well, really just tweaking on those kinds of things, but carrying on the rest of your life the way you want it. We too, here in Calgary, are shaped by our context. We're shaped by the way we go about our day as well. We have people that are engineers, they're in the education field, they're in the medical field, the healthcare field, etc. And that shapes and influences who we are and how we behave and how we conduct ourselves. And it also comes into how we are as a church, a congregation. So we have constitutions, we have org charts, we have processes. We do these kinds of things that are familiar with what we would call perhaps a secular standard of leadership and organization. But is it right that we depend on that? That is our actual first priority when it comes to matters of the church? There are people that you and I know, and many of us here this morning and on live stream, are thirsty and hungry for spiritual life, spiritual replenishment, spiritual fulfillment. Some of those people come to church and find it. Some of those people come to church and don't find it. And as we have been discussing over the last few Sundays, the statistics bear out that many people have just essentially either stopped coming or don't go to church at all because they're not finding it. And there is a penchant in church history over the last number of decades, and it is for us a penchant possible as well today, and that is something that I would call retail spirituality. And that is that churches with this understanding of this desire for spiritual hunger and depth and replenishment, that churches with our business acumen and our prowess for leadership and organization, we develop what is a retail spirituality, which is we appeal to individualism and consumerism as a way to reach people with the gospel and the good news. Melinda Lindquist Denton and Christian Smith wrote a book some time ago called Soul Searching, and they did a massive study among teenagers. Their study was in the U.S., but there's a lot of overlap with Canada as well. And what teenagers basically came to the conclusion that Christianity is really, Melissa and Christian developed this phrase, moralistic therapeutic deism, which is that teens basically view Christianity as, it can be boiled down to, well, it's just moral living, live a good moral life and you'll be happy and do well, or that Christianity and God is really about therapy for you. That's what they have come to the conclusion that Christianity is about. And yet what we hear and what we know is that our Creator is a giving Creator who gives gifts over and over and over. He bestows gifts on each and every disciple and follower of Jesus Christ, from the youngest to the oldest. Why does he do that? Why does he give gifts? Why do we have these gifts? Well, what's one thing for us to know about this variety pack of spiritual gifts? Well, if you would turn with me to 1 Corinthians 12. What's important to know about this variety pack of spiritual gifts? 1 Corinthians 12, verse 4. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. It is the one and only Trinitarian God who gives this variety of gifts. It is this one and only God, this Trinitarian God. And you hear this language here, and we use the phrase Trinity. Trinity is actually not a word that you would find in the Bible itself, in Scripture. It is a real vital part of our belief system and understanding of God in what we would call three persons. We use that word person as a way to try and reach an understanding of what God is like. But you can hear it here when the writer Paul says the Spirit, pneuma, Lord, Kyrios, God, Theos. And the Holy Spirit here already, again, developed after hearing from Scripture and disciples and so on, Paul describes the Holy Spirit as a living being. That's what we call a person, if you will. Someone who has a will and actions and feelings. That's the Holy Spirit. And so, to put it clearly, this variety of spiritual gifts, there are many gifts, but one giver. In fact, the diversity of the gifts is a revelation, a disclosure of the nature of our Creator. That He is able to do all of this bestowing of gifts in these variety. But what kind of gifts? What are we talking about? Well, let's continue. What kind of gifts? Verse 8. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. In that spiritual gift study guide, you will see actually a brief description of these spiritual gifts that are listed here. But if we were summarizing, we could say by looking at this that there are a range of spiritual gifts. There are potent gifts, practical and profound. Everything from wisdom to healing to prophecy is listed here. It's amazing the variety. And in Scripture, Paul writes and Peter writes in different books in the New Testament, there are other lists of spiritual gifts. And there are other orders of on that list. And you'll see that in that spiritual guide study guide as well. That there are other lists and there are different orders and there are other combinations. And so it isn't a human priority. For example, music from the Old Testament on, this idea that music was included, singers, musicians, even people that crafted and made things. So what we can understand by reading this, but also in the context of other scripture, is that this is not a comprehensive list. It is not intended to be a comprehensive list, but these are spiritual gifts, at least at a minimum. And how are they distributed? How are we receiving and getting these variety of spiritual gifts? Well, that we see in verse 11. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. The Holy Spirit chooses. The Holy Spirit chooses and decides and gives. One Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is not neutral here. So Jesus is the head of the church and we gather in Jesus' name, but the Holy Spirit is also active and decidedly not neutral. The Holy Spirit is choosing individuals and choosing gifts for specific individuals and choosing the church and choosing people and gifts and putting all of that together. The Holy Spirit has chosen a gift for every follower of Jesus Christ. It has been hand-picked for you. This word gift is charisma, which is really the root of it is charis, which is the Greek word for grace. So it is like God's grace that He gives you this grace. I love the language of this. We say charisma. Every follower of Jesus has charisma. Even the quiet and stoic ones. Because of the work of the Holy Spirit. But that still leaves us with why. Why does He give these gifts? Why do we have these gifts? And there it is in verse 7, right in the middle of all of it. To each is given the manifestation, the making of, the revelation of, the made clear of, the revelation of the Spirit. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. The Holy Spirit has chosen a gift for you, and it's for everybody else. It's for the good of the congregation. The phrase common good here, but that's anything but common in a context of individualism and freedom and all of that, that the spiritual gift that has been chosen and bestowed on you, allotted to you, maybe more than one, is for other people. It's like re-gifting. You've been gifted in order to be a gift for the rest of the congregation. It's like holy re-gifting. Do you see what I'm saying? You've been, the Holy Spirit has chosen. The Holy Spirit says, I have this gift or these gifts, and I give them to you, I allot them to you, so that you will be a gift to the congregation. Because the Lord is particularly interested in the congregation. In the health and well-being of the body of believers. Because the congregation has a ministry. The ministry of the community. This community, this congregation of Westview, we have a ministry. And He wants us to be fit and able and active. That word active is interesting to me. It's like we have this gift that He has given us. I like Diet Coke. I drink Diet Coke. I did. One of my friends is a medical doctor, and I was telling him, you know, about some sleep challenges that I was having, and he said, well, maybe you should switch to caffeine-free Diet Coke. And I tried it. But after a little while, I figured, caffeine-free Diet Coke, I'm like, why do I even bother? But it's fantastic. So if you think of either each of us individually or as a congregation, individuals are a gift, and we as a congregation are a gift. Fit and able and active. It's not very active. Incidentally, that Greek word active is energeo. It's where we get the word energy from. Energize. The Holy Spirit energizes. He activates the spiritual gifts in us, and he activates the congregation. He activates, energeo, us as individuals and us as a congregation. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, with the activation of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, friends, brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit resources His church. The Holy Spirit resources His church, and He gives gifts to His church. The difference between a community group and a social gathering and a congregation of followers of Jesus Christ who will be effective in a world that desperately needs good news and the gospel, the difference will be our yielding and seeking the work and the ministry of the Holy Spirit as we gather in Jesus' name. And we learn about processes. We learn about techniques. I am there with you. I have a list of business designations in engineering and all these different things back in my days before full-time ministry, and we learn about all those things, but those things have a location. And later on, when we talk about this workshop that Tyler is going to do, he's going to talk about the personality and experience and abilities and how we locate those within relationship to the spiritual gifts. But the spiritual gifts take priority. And when the spiritual gifts take priority, when the Holy Spirit takes priority, we know that that is a guarantee that there will be a coordination and a cooperation and a unity, because the priority is the Holy Spirit and not our business acumen or our prowess or our ability to manage a project. That takes second or third or fourth place. In fact, our secret confidence is in the work of the Trinity and the power of the Holy Spirit that is at work within us. That's our secret confidence. And what's so beautiful is that He has chosen individuals, and He has chosen the congregation. Yes, He is absolutely interested in individuals. He leaves the 99 to go and bring back the one, but He brings the one to the 99 because He's interested in both you and us, because there is a ministry that this community has that the Lord has intended. And when we yield and allow Him to activate. And so we realize our full potential. You will realize your full potential as an individual. Listen to me. Your purpose and your full potential, when you discern and you discover and you employ those spiritual gifts, that our Creator Almighty has chosen and allotted to you. That we don't quench it, that we don't hinder it, that we don't stymie the work of the Holy Spirit, but instead we say, come Holy Spirit, I want to discern, I want to discover, I want to employ, I want to use for the greater good of this ministry that you have intended and planned for us and chosen for us for this time. Some months ago, I went to visit went with a couple of gentlemen from this congregation, two other gentlemen from this congregation, and the three of us went to visit some congregants. I could tell you stories already because I'm seeing the work of the Holy Spirit in individuals already. But these two gentlemen and I went to visit some congregants, and we had an amazing visit. And as we were driving away, I said to these two gents, I said, I see Christ in you. I just saw him in you. The way you conducted yourself, the posture that you had, it was amazing. I was sitting there, I was just blown away. The presence of the Lord, I saw the presence of God in these gentlemen as they were in this home and we were communicating with these congregants. I want to pause for some Q&R. And then we will finish up here. If you have a question online or here, you can send those to Ask at Westview Church, or you can stand where you are and ask your question. We'll bring a microphone to you. Tyler will bring a mic to you, and we'll have your question. Does someone have something they want to ask?
Are you going to finish the rest of that?
No, okay, I don't think so. I like DC, but not that much.
Yeah, one great question to begin, and then again, if there are others here, but maybe paint a picture for how will the church be a more effective church if we all understand and live out our spiritual gifts?
Yeah, how will we be a more effective church if we're living out? So the first sort of thing, the premise behind spiritual gifts is they are for the benefit of others. And so spiritual gifts turn our focus away from ourselves and turn our focus toward other people. And that is a significant, huge rotation already. And the ability to discern what are those spiritual gifts, and to employ these things that are more than just human constructs. We had a few in this list of prophecy, utterance of wisdom. They are beyond human abilities. That's why we title this superpowers. So it becomes much more dynamic, much more effective, and the congregation then becomes a witness to people who come either on Sunday morning or during the week. So that's a start, at least. Yeah, that's good.
And I think you'll elaborate on that in the next few weeks, and so that's what's exciting about this series. And perhaps maybe share a little bit more about just the inventory, this questionnaire, and kind of what can we expect? You've been working a lot on that, and I mean, questionnaires are good, but
right, yeah. And so maybe that's what I'll do. Considering the time, maybe I'll jump to that. Do you have some others?
Let's go here because I know you're going to answer that one. I think, but help us understand even a bit maybe the relationship between spiritual gifts and fruit of the Spirit, because I think sometimes those can get kind of confused or jumbled together.
Sure. So that's a really good question. The difference between spiritual gifts and fruit of the Spirit. So again, fruit of the Spirit would be, you could consider them like virtues or attributes. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. So those are about character. They're like attributes or virtues that are, again, reflected from the Holy Spirit. So that's what the Lord is like, God is like. The gifts, the spiritual gifts, are, again, I use this phrase superpowers, but they are abilities or things that you are able to do because the Holy Spirit is enabling you to do these kinds of activities, these kinds of functions, these kinds of works.
Awesome. Yeah. And I think those are not unique to all. We all have those spiritual fruit of the Spirit, that we all have the capacity to live those out. Whereas
we desire that Westview, as we come out of this pandemic and as we heal through the trauma of that, and as we look ahead and look forward to the growth and development of Westview and what the Lord has intended for us, we want to be a church that is gift-based, that has a priority on the headship of Jesus Christ and an empowerment of the Holy Spirit. That is where our confidence is. And so we desire that you will take this spiritual gift study guide, that the various groups, youth and young adults and SAGE and so on, will use this in your personal studies, community groups, to investigate and learn and study this. Whether we have a high degree of participation, and then you'll see also this questionnaire. It's available on our website as well, electronically. And it's a way for you to take this quiz in order to begin to discern what are some of your most prominent spiritual gifts. And it'll be wonderful for us when you do that to share that with other people, but also that you share that with the office. Because in a practical way, when we are looking at other positions within ministries, we want to match people with your spiritual gifts, so that we understand the spiritual gifts that people have and we match them with the different ministries and maybe with different aspects that you come forward with. And so that's something we need to know. And then you will also be delighted to know that Hanukkah, our pastor of child and family ministry, Westview Kids, starting this morning and for a series of weeks, is also going to be studying this aspect of spiritual gifts. From a child perspective, so age-appropriate perspective, Hanukkah has material both for the K to 4 and the 5s and 6s. And so over the coming weeks, starting this morning, they will be going through that as well. And then Tyler is going to be facilitating a workshop called SHAPE. That'll be later on in November. SHAPE stands for spiritual gifts, heart, or you could say passion, abilities, personality, and experience. So we have all of that. You have these things. But we have these spiritual gifts. And so how does all of that work together? Tyler's going to lead a couple of workshops to walk us through that so that we are wholly dependent and desirous of the work of the Holy Spirit, and that you discern and discover the superpowers that He has chosen for you.
This new song again. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. Why don't you stand with us? Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Thank you. Thank you for coming this morning. Thank you for joining us on our live stream. If you have kids, you can pick them up from their classes upstairs. We have an offering box at the back for you. If there's a few of you who could help stack chairs, that would be great. And people from our prayer team are available to the prayer room to your right there if you need prayer this morning. Let me declare these words over us this morning from Psalm 119. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God bless you. See you next Sunday. You've done.